Great pleasure. Again, traditionally coming to the Energy Summer School, Diplomatic Academy. I believe that it's a very important venue. Welcome to Azerbaijan. My understanding that through the 2 weeks, you have very intensive discussion, and not only working sessions, but as well as a pleasant session. You are on the shores of Caspian Sea, so it's also joyful, I believe, not only workable for you. I believe that during these 2 weeks of discussions and statements and presentations which was done by our officials to you, I will not going again and again, as Ambassador Bashayev told me, to discuss the history. I will tell you the foreign policy priorities of Azerbaijan, how we believe and we see here, how we build up. You know, the last year we just celebrated the 20th anniversary of restoration of our independence. I strongly believe, for example, that it's Azerbaijan, this 20 years, it's a third republic. The first was established in 1918. Then in 1922, Azerbaijan, together with Armenia and Georgia as a Transcaucasian Federation, joined the Soviet Union on the 30th of December. Then we moved to the Second Republic. It was a quasi-independence because part of our foreign policy and defense policy we delivered to Moscow, and doing it within the Union of Soviet Socialist Republic up to the 1991, when we regained our full independence, establishing and controlling defense and foreign policy back to our hands. Foreign policy of Azerbaijan, as correctly was indicated, the foreign ministry of Azerbaijan established in 1918. We celebrated this year on the 9th of July, the 94th anniversary of establishment of the foreign ministry in Azerbaijan. In 1922, as I said, after they delivered the priorities and foreign policy back to given to Moscow, and then the foreign ministry was in Azerbaijan cancelled as it's functioning in 1927 until the 1944, when Mr. Stalin, at that time during the discussion of the United Nations, really interested that all the Soviet republics should also gain the membership in the UN, and therefore in 1944 they established the foreign ministries in all Soviet republics. Unfortunately to us in Azerbaijan, President Roosevelt's thinking in a different way when he introduced that all, at that time, 47 states of United States of America should also gain the membership at the United Nations. So the compromise was that Ukraine and Belarus gained the seats at the United Nations, and we unfortunately did not gain the membership at the UN, where we joined this organization in 1992. Sorry, I believe that after that, the Stalin still keep in mind that one day he will return all the republics back to the United Nations. So we still have the foreign ministry, which, as correctly told by Fariz, I joined on the, in February of 1983. And there was only 13 people, because 13, 1, 3. My ID was issued to me, It was number 13, and it was all together. Minister, driver, and everyone all together was 13 people in our foreign ministry. I like a number, And then when we regained our independence, of course, we faced with a lot of challenges. And then the foreign policy of Azerbaijan, starting not from the scratch, as we say, but even below the scratch, as you probably aware, some speakers during their statements and presentation told about the biggest problem which we're facing up to now. It's unresolved conflict with Armenia. In 1991, it was still one part of the hot period of the war, and at that time, when we responded to the challenges, Azerbaijan, in our foreign policy, very intensively, all the discussions with negotiations organization, OSCE, at that time it was a conference for security and cooperation in Europe. After all the efforts, because everyone recognized that it was part of our modern history, established a so-called Minsk group. Why Minsk? Because negotiations was going so intensively, and we believe that we can find out the common language with Armenia. So there was defined that Minsk, as the capital of Belarus, should be place for hosting a conference where we can finalize the legally binding agreement for the settlement of the conflict with Armenia. Unfortunately, we failed, but Minsk group is still Minsk group. That's OSCE Minsk group who is dealing with the settlement. Besides that, the whole period of war was stopped in 1994 with the ceasefire agreement with Armenia, and which is very fragile. From time to time, on the line of contact, we have shootings. As a result of whole part of period of war, almost 20% of territory of Azerbaijan is under occupation, and all of the territories which is under occupation are ethnically cleansed, which created almost 1 million of refugees and IDPs, because it's not only indigenous population on the occupied territories, but as well as the Azerbaijani population from Armenia was expelled. There was also unfortunate fact, which I have to also mention, that the Armenian population who live in Azerbaijan also leave the territory of Azerbaijan. So altogether, we have a very nasty and very unfortunate situation with these refugees and IDPs, both in Armenia and Azerbaijan, and this notorious practice of ethnic cleansing and occupation, which is definitely creating one and probably the biggest challenge to the foreign policy of my country. As a point of negotiations in 1997 within the Minsk group, there was a decision to establish a co-chairmanship rather than bringing 9 to 12 countries. We agreed that it should be a co-chairmanship, which now led to blend from 97 by United States, Russia, and France. Negotiations is going on. We have meetings, hundreds of them probably, with my Armenian counterpart. Meetings also between the presidents of Armenia and Azerbaijan is going on, trying to define the way how we should proceed for the breakthrough on negotiations with Armenia. So far, the plan which was proposed and initially introduced in December of 2009, it goes as a updated Madrid principles. We agree that we should define the principles first and then move to the comprehensive peace agreement, working on it. Therefore, the plan is very simple. It's a step-by-step approach. We recognize that all the territories surrounding FK, which is 7 of their districts, which never ever, were never ever, even single Armenian used to live, but which are now under occupation, that Armenian troops should be withdrawn from these territories. According to the United Nations Security Council, 4 of them, which was adopted in 1993. And then it will open the opportunity that, as usual, the compromise is that Armenian troops withdraw from the occupied territories. And Nagorno-Karabakh will provide it with the interim status, so-called white interim, because of the agreement that the final definition of the legal status of NK should be done on the later stage, whenever the normalization situation will be happened. For us, it's of course important that Azerbaijani indigenous population will be turned back to Nagorno-Karabakh. And then both communities will decide the future status of NK, as we recognize it within the territorial integrity of Azerbaijan as a part of our lands, as we always say, just the world and international relations know a lot of good examples of high-level autonomy, something like, as we've been discussing, is something like Turkmenistan, for example, the Russian Federation. Or it can be used as a case of Trieste in Italy or any other, Tatarstan or Bashkirtistan, or Trieste of Italy or Åland Islands of between Finland and Sweden, and so on. Unfortunately, I cannot tell you that we reach the level of breakthrough, despite that both sides have recognized that this is probably the best way how we need to make to find out the deal. And that's what Paul was saying, that war is not the case, but diplomacy is not exhausted. Unfortunately, again, as I said, on the line of contact, there is the shootings, including the casualties, and this is not the best way for any foreign minister of any world, how he will see most of his days are dedicated to that kind of problem. With regard to the vision for the other priorities of our foreign policy, of course, as an energy producing country, and probably again, the other speakers here told you as out about our intention that the not only oil but natural gas will go to the European market. We also put the priorities of strengthening our cooperation with NATO and European Union. Despite that, Azerbaijan is a member of non-aligned movement, but our cooperation with NATO is going quite successful. We are in the third phase of individual partnership action plan. We believe that this individual partnership action plan is a good institution for conducting more reforms, not only in army, but as well as in the other law enforcement agencies. And we so far is doing a lot of things that making our cooperation with NATO mutually beneficial. Azerbaijan is also part of the different NATO-led campaigns, including in Afghanistan, sending our troops. We are supporting NATO efforts in Afghanistan for more stable and sustainable Afghanistan, even beyond of 2014, as you're probably aware that this is the time when the NATO troops will be withdrawn from Afghanistan, most of them. And part of this transit it's to Afghanistan, it's running through Azerbaijan. Almost 30% of cargo which is going to Afghanistan is going through Azerbaijan. And now we're negotiating with the member states, NATO member states, that when the transit will go back, that they can use the facilities of Azerbaijan, including the seaports, airports, and even the railroad, which is going to inaugurate it in 2013, next year, which connected the railroad system and network between Azerbaijan, Georgia, and Turkey. We, by the way, NATO's, NATO countries is considering this road as the most reliable, as well as the closest to the territory of the NATO member state, which is Turkey. That's the closest way that they can reach the territory of the NATO members. With EU cooperation is going on, also successful within the Eastern Partnership. We believe that it's a good institution, which we're definitely using for bringing more standards, European standards to Azerbaijan. We start with Bologna process in education, Erasmus programs, the standards of European Union starting from the ecological or even construction, infrastructural projects, construction of the roads, highways. It's already introduced. We now are doing a very ambitious plan, particularly which bind also with ecology and to reform and modernization of our refineries, bringing the gasoline up to Euro 3, and then within the next 3-5 years up to Euro 5, which means that the whole the cars and the tier cars and so on is going to be much more ecologically friendly. I think that dealing with European states. We do not forget, as I said, with the rest of the world, Azerbaijan is a member of our organization, Islamic Cooperation. We are a member of the non-aligned movement, and this is a good video allowing us to present our country as a reliable partner. Frankly speaking, that part of the foreign policy already assists us when we, through the 17 rounds of voting last year at the General Assembly of the United Nations, can gain 155 votes after the strong competition with Hungary and Slovenia, and win the one seat as a non-permanent member of the Security Council. That's what we say that one of the good achievements of the foreign policy, because we can introduce our case, the case of Azerbaijan, as a reliable partner, reliable representative for the case of the Third World, the particular non-aligned movement or Islamic cooperation organization, and so on. So that will give us a huge support. Frankly speaking, the last week and even beyond of that, dealing with all the case of Syria, including the sleepless nights, because the voting was done on a very nervous atmosphere. If you will watch today TV, you probably will see how was the verbal fight between the Russians, Chinese versus United States, France, UK, regarding the developments in Syria. And as a small country, as Azerbaijan, you're always trying to find out the way how to proceed successfully through the what the big guys are getting their own interest in this case. But so far we supported the resolution, vote in favor, and we believe that the Syrian case should be solved through the support of the Kofi Annan plan. And of course, President Bashar Assad should recognize as a president that he should do even triple his efforts to bring more stability to the country. If he cannot do it, so this is the case that as a president, he should be more responsible. Therefore, this is not the problem of Bashar Assad, this is a problem probably of the Syrian people. And in this regard, of course, as a member state of the Security Council, we're standing strongly for the promoting of the peace and security in Syria. I think that, of course, when I talk, I should tell you a few words about energy diplomacy. Of course, for the foreign ministry and the foreign policy of Azerbaijan, energy diplomacy is playing a huge and vital role. We believe that it's a great asset. Somebody is talking about energy as a curse. I don't think so. I believe that having oil and gas, besides that, it helps us to develop the country. It's helped us to build up a human capital, invest into the education of the future generation of our people, and get the benefits to all and every person, citizen of Azerbaijan. And it also helped us when we're promoting our foreign policy, introducing our country, and energy diplomacy as a part of also on the daily basis, working with our different partners, with understanding that sooner, for example, Azerbaijani, in that case, not energy, but natural gas, will reach reliable consumers. Through the transit, as I said, from Georgia, and now we sign a very, very strategically important project with Turkey, Trans-Anatolian Pipeline, TANAP. And this project, of the strategic importance, I believe, on the same level as Baku Tbilisi-Ceyhan Pipeline, or on the same level as construction of the railroad connecting the railroad network between Azerbaijan, Georgia, and Turkey, but with BBC cars. That kind of project startup is also getting its own hands. Now, you're probably aware, we are negotiating, including the foreign ministry involved in that, with our different partners, where it will go after the gas will reach the border with the European Union. TANAP is coming up to the border with Bulgaria. it can go further on through Greece, Albania, to the north of Italy, so-called Trans-Adriatic pipeline. It's about 8 to 12 billion cubic meters of gas. Or it can go to the Nabucco West, so-called, up to the Austrian city of Baumgarten, where there's a huge gas storages, which then can be delivered to all around different countries of Europe. But it should go through Bulgaria, further on through Balkans, Romania, and further on to Austria. Negotiations are going on. Of course, it's not only the decision of the government of Azerbaijan, including the foreign ministry involvement, but as well as it's extremely important the role of companies, including those who are running Azerbaijan-Kunashli offshore field, which is deep gas, and Shardanis phase two, because the investments up to 20 billion US dollars should be done by British Petroleum, Statoil, and the rest of the consortium of Shardanis, and investment will go for the bringing it up to the 60 billion cubic meters exploration. And then, of course, companies should be involved to define the final destination of the natural gas of Azerbaijan, where it will go to the northern Italy or to the Austrian Baumgarten, Austrian city of Baumgarten, or and in both directions, because the proven reserves of Azerbaijan in natural gas is 2.8 billion trillion cubic meters. And we have, with the latest discovery by Total, French company Total, Absheron offshore, that estimation around 300 to 358 billion cubic meters. It means that it can be additional 10 billion cubic meters of natural gas. So altogether, we believe that the option are there. The decision should be, final decision should be made up to the mid of the next year. Next year, generally speaking. From the political point of view, I see that European market is very reliable, and we believe in this market and in this consumer. Of course, it will be our probably modest, but very strong contribution into the energy security of Europe. We do not sometimes thinking that we can be a competitor to other suppliers of natural gas to the European market. We just working with our partners and with our existing volumes. So we believe that the European market, according to the forecast, if financial crisis is not going to be intervened, is going to be increased. The gas market in Europe, particularly when Germany made a decision to close down and shut down all the nuclear power station facilities, that the interest for the natural gas of Azerbaijan as a supplier to the European market is will be profoundly supportive and will cut our own consumers. So far, I believe that you have a lot of questions. I don't want to repeat again my predecessors with their presentation. I will be more than happy to pick up your questions and respond it as honest as I can or as any foreign minister. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Minister. I should note that this is a very interesting group, Mr. Minister, because we have many diplomats this year participating from our neighboring countries. We are from Bulgaria, Israel, Romania, if I'm forgetting some other countries, United Arab Emirates, Switzerland. So this is actually, your speech is very much related to the interest of some of the participants. So we have some, NATO, are you, you have a question or you are, you want me to mention that you're from NATO? So we have some time to open up for questions. Please raise your hand, introduce yourself, and I'll give you the floor. We'll start from that corner, please.
My name is Markus Volic. I'm a diplomat from Norway, working now in the EU Embassy.
Speak to the mic. Or speak loudly.
My name is Markus Volic. I'm a diplomat from Norway, working now in the Norwegian Embassy in Baku. Your Excellency, I'm wondering about what is your vision for Azerbaijan's relationship with the EU? Let's say in 5 or 10 minutes time from now. And And is the Eastern Partnership a strong enough mechanism to achieve that, what you want? My second question is, what role will Azerbaijan play in the withdrawal of NATO troops from Afghanistan? Thank you.
Let me pick up a few questions and then that will be easy to respond.
Yes, please raise your hand so I can see. I'll give to Iraqi participant, NATO, and Hussein.
Excuse me, I'm Elmar Al-Hafiz. I'm from Minister of Foreign Affairs from Iraq, from Baghdad. This means Hujazi Vice my Minister, your friend.
Yes.
And I'm so thankful about this big amount of education and information we've got at this course. But more important than that, we want to translate this information in ground about the relationship between Iraq and Azerbaijan. And to do that, we need materials. And Iraqi people were very interested about the businesses coming here in oil and other things. And to do that, we need the materials, as I told, a big embassy was being opened at Baghdad and a big office of Azar's business center there to make a relationship good and to start that. And I want to note that our parliaments have all agreements and everything is okay, and even our embassy is working now. So ask when we can have this material to make our education useful.
Thank you. Julius?
Julius
Dostas
from Headquarters. So one of my biggest takeaways from these meetings was that Azerbaijan's foreign policy is a balancing policy. Between different countries and regions like EU, US, Iran, Russia, Turkey. And my question is this foreign policy a sustainable one? Do you see Azerbaijan following this policy in the longer term, or will it eventually drift to one side? Because it is a challenge.
Hussein Tanahov from Azerbaijan. First of all, thank you for your very informative presentation. My question is about Azeri-Iranian relations. I would like to ask if, relations between Azerbaijan and Iran have not been improving for the last 6-7 months, to say the least. Do you think there's any threat of Iran attacking Azerbaijani oil fields or gas fields in the Caspian?
Okay. One by one. First, welcome to Azerbaijan. That's working, I believe, in a Norwegian embassy in Azerbaijan is an excellent opportunity for you to expand your vision. I don't know if you first served abroad in the first assignment or you served in other countries, but at least some of the European Union diplomats saying that serving this places as Azerbaijan is much interesting rather than if you were serving in your embassy in Luxembourg or in Poland, because everything is doing by Brussels rather than in the capitals. I think that I already mentioned about our relations with EU and Eastern Partnership. I think that from one point of view, despite that, frankly, absolutely frankly speaking, that the formula which is introduced by Eastern Partnership, more for more, it's a little bit humiliating for us. What is more and what for more? Rather than we believe that we can use Eastern Partnership as an institution, as an avenue, where we can get the access to more, bringing more values and standards of European countries for Azerbaijan. I think that Norway is an excellent example, together with Switzerland, that you are integrated into the European surface, but you are not a member of EU, for example, or Switzerland, despite that you're using the whole privileges of that. So I think that for us, it's not the point of the membership, and we are not putting the way that, oh, no, definitely we want to be a member of NATO or EU and so on. We're speaking that we're building up our policy towards these organizations as a point that there was question for NATO, that which allow us to doing more reforms and do not invent a new bicycle rather than getting already agreed and already used standards, which is proven to be very successful and then introduce to our state, to Azerbaijan. Of course, approaching this case by case, because something which is good for Norway or Poland or the Luxembourg cannot fly here. So therefore, we are approaching, because we are still, this is the beauty of the world when the people are diversified. And the diversity of the mankind is probably one of the best what we can, with all this accepting the opinions, rather than doing everything as the same line. We have a bad experience in the past with the Soviet Union style, so we don't want to repeat the same mistake that everyone should run within the same line, and that's it, period. So therefore, approaching to this this cooperation, of course, we believe that within the Eastern Partnership, Azerbaijan is probably one of the most important parts among the other six countries. And we, for example, introduce for Brussels that we do not looking for association agreement, rather than we need to build up a strategic partnership. We already signed with the EU strategic partnership on energy issues, but we believe that it should be expanded further on to the other areas of our cooperation with the European Union. On NATO troops withdrawal from Afghanistan, it's part that we have very intensively discussed in Brussels. As I said, we introduced this road to Azerbaijan. There is a few options. Part of it, as I said, using the railroad through the Central Asia up to Azerbaijan and then up to Turkey. The other option is airlifting air flights to Baku airport and then using the railroads. And the third one is a combination, air flights with railroads and up to the Georgian ports on the Black Sea and further on by ships, or directly through the Turkey to the Turkish seaport, Mersin. So all of the options is open. Negotiations is going on because it should be calculated. The feasibility, what was the best, because you know that there are the three options. The Pakistani road, the closest one, but probably unstable. Through Ulyanovsk, through Russia, it's the longest way through Central Asia, and the shortest from through Azerbaijan. And we are ready to provide all kind of assistance in this regard and sit down and negotiate the terms of agreement. On Iraq, embassy is on the way. As soon as I get the consent of finance minister, that the protection for the security reasons. Opening our embassy in Baghdad, your minister provide me all the guarantees for the security, I'm accepting that, but still I need to be protected from the point of view that he will get at least an armed vehicle. An armed vehicle, it's not the BMW that you can go to the shop and buy it. You have to deal first with the Minister of Finance and then the agreement. But I believe that, first, my best regards to Mr. Khashoggi, saying that I'm on the way to visit him in Baghdad, as I promised, this year, for sure. I wish that with all formalization of our bureaucracy, I can bring my ambassador with me. I wish that I can use the arguments that Minister of Finance cannot refuse, and then we will sign up for the embassy opening. Besides that, our relations with Iraq is running beyond of our independence. Even during the Soviet time, there was a Consul General of Iraq in Azerbaijan, and there was a lot of students in Azerbaijan from Iraq. They're still working in the oil business. I think that for our ambassador it will be very easy, because you can find out the fraternity of Azerbaijani graduates in Iraq. And we have very deeply hearted feelings with the more stronger, stable Iraq and prosperity. We have a lot of in common. And I think that sooner you reach the whole stability and security of the whole territory of Iraq, it's better for everyone and all players in the region. Foreign policy. You know, it's a little bit contradictory when we're saying, again, when we say balanced foreign policy, balanced ways. We are not building and labeling our foreign policy as a that we try to please someone, because balance means that we try to please, you're trying to please someone, just do not go against some interests or support. We always saying that the foreign policy of Azerbaijan is serving national interests of the country. And this is number one. in number two, if you miss the number one, so look to the point number one. So in that case, everything which is running for the national interest of the country, it should be used. Even sometimes moving to the next question, our relations with Iran. Yes, we to some extent, as all the neighbors, we have to some problems which we have to resolve, and people have the problems even within the family, between the brothers and sisters or parents and kids. We recognize that some of the issue which needs to be solved, like for example immediately, like for example the arrest of our two poets, and foreign ministry is working very hard with this regard. We were requesting that not the release, but at least that the consul should visit, according to the Vienna Convention on Consular Relations. It should be allowed to him to visit those who are arrested as citizens of the country. And in this regard, of course, sometimes it's a questioning that on what stage Azerbaijan and Iran's relationship. I think that in two words I will say just, we respecting Iranian position on various issues of the international agenda, and we expecting that Iran will respect on the same level position of Azerbaijan on various issues of the international agenda. And in this regard, of course, we are ready to build even stronger relations with Iran. It's our immediate neighbor. There is a lot of Azerbaijanis who are living there. We have a relative contact with Azerbaijan. We have a connection with Nakhichevan because of the blockade and occupation territories through territory of Iran. And we have a lot of joint programs. As a person who are co-chairing the governmental group of cooperation between Azerbaijan and Iran, I can tell you that we have a lot of different programs which are under development, and it's for the benefits of the people of Iran and Azerbaijan. And I believe that we can handle all the issues. It should not be a problem.
Okay, so we'll take another round of questions. Please raise your hand if you have any. We'll start with Italian guy, Romanian guy, and Romanian girl, and the next person.
Minister, buongiorno. I'm Nicola Sartori from Italy. Thank you very much for your presentation, and in particular for explaining us how energy can drive your foreign security and defense policy. My question is quite tough because it is grounded in the period of your reality. And the question is, if, according to your opinion, if Azerbaijan at the beginning of the 90s had the current energy global posture, do you think the Nagorno-Karabakh today would be part of Azerbaijan and not Armenia?
Romanian participant.
My question would be a very easy one to counterbalance the question of my colleague. Minister, Azerbaijan is a young country, and the Minister of Foreign Affairs, I think we can say it's a young institution as well. My question is related to your foreign missions abroad. I wanted to ask you, what's the policy of developing them? If you could tell me, what's the number of your current embassies, and what are the plans for the future? Thank you.
Okay, this next one.
Thank you, dear Minister, coming here. I'm going to give an informative presentation. Akshen Yolsev Sokar. I have a question about the Azerbaijan relation with Europe. It's obvious that Azerbaijan and Europe has a good business relationship, but there is some still challenges exist in terms of like visa getting, like Azerbaijan citizens getting visa to Europe and the vice versa. But as I have heard, there is some ongoing negotiations. When we can expect some certain result, and which kind of the mitigating conditions we are talking about. Thank you.
Mr. Minister, if you allow, I'll also give a chance to our master student. She's not a summer school participant, but she's our master student from Gambia. And I'm expecting she will ask the question when we open embassy in Gambia.
Is that true?
Thank you very much, Excellency. I'm from the Gambia. My name is Hadi. I'm a graduate student at ADA. I have two questions for you. The first one was, I want to know, what is your ministry's position with regards to the chairmanship of the Minsk group, especially with regards to France? How far do you think national interest of the three chairs, co-chairs of the Minsk group affects the effective functioning of the negotiations you're making at the Minsk group? And the second question is, I would like to know, from Romania, just asked a little bit from the question. I wanted to know the extent of your diplomatic relations with African countries, because Azerbaijan is little known in Africa. What steps are you taking to, make that better? Are you opening embassies? And currently, what's the extent of your relations with which countries? Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for all the questions. Answering the question from Italian, I think that in foreign policy, you cannot respond to the question when it starts if, because it's very hypothetical. We believe that it should be more pragmatic. It's very difficult that if something happened, it would be this way or that. Of course. Doing the forecast, it's not a part of our policy, but realistically speaking, we have to build a strategy, which we are building now, explaining to the Armenian community of Nagorno-Karabakh that it's in their interest to live in the wealthy, prosperous country and being a loyal citizen, rather than living with the entity which is not recognized by anyone, and which is be a pariah state or whatever, pariah entity or whatever you call it, with zero chances to be recognized as an independent state, and zero chances, even minus chances, to be annexed to Armenia. Because even Armenia themselves, the leadership in the capital of Armenia, do not recognize the independence of UK. And therefore, of course, there will be no one in the world will agree that Karabakh can be a part of Armenia. So therefore, part of our job, as we believe, and it's promoting the interest that Armenian citizens of NK are loyal citizens of Azerbaijan, which they should be, and we consider them as our citizens, and now explaining them that it's the best chance for them to be within the high level autonomy within Azerbaijan, but using the all benefits which they can. I was an ambassador to Italy. I travel a lot in Italy, in the northern part, what I say about Trieste or Mirana case and so on. For example, the taxes, the agreement between Italy and Austria was very successful one, providing up to the 95 in different cases, 95 taxes keeping for the citizens of this area, including budget support for growth. And that's probably using with the opening borders, with the traveling go around, with an excellent level of education, that's probably one of the way how it should be addressed. Our point is that we have to educate these people, getting more information, what's going to be the benefits, what they're going to get the access, what can be the beneficial for them and profitable for them, including the economic perspectives, including the humanitarian stuff, and so on. With double questions on our foreign policy, we have 72 embassies, consul generals, and missions to the international organizations. Now it's on the way to open embassy, as I said, Iraq, fighting with Minister of Finance, but already made a decision to open embassy in Australia. It's next in line. We have also different other countries where decision is made. In our case, according to the Constitution, decision of making of foreign embassies abroad is done by the Parliament of Azerbaijan. sometimes I'm trying to criticize, but to change it, we have to hold a referendum to change the constitution. Unfortunately, for me, it's a constitutional provision. But at least because the parliament already adopted that we should open also embassy Iraq, Australia, Vietnam, Taiwan, Consul General in Odessa, Ukraine, and somebody else. In Africa, we already have embassies in Egypt, in Libya, in Morocco, in South Africa. We are planning to put one person in Addis Ababa because it's the best way to deal with the African Union as a headquarters and different African states. In Gambia, we have our ambassador from Morocco, who is also accredited to Gambia as well as to Senegal and other countries of Western Africa. Of course, this is the policy which will be introduced more and more. Frankly speaking, I don't believe that we will have altogether more than 100 postings, because for our size country it will be sufficiently enough, taking more on the regional basis and approach. Visa regime, my understanding that we negotiated within the Eastern Partnership for visa facilitation. We introduced our proposals that we say that easiest regime with the European Union will be beneficial for the first and foremost for the people of for the European Union and Azerbaijan. And we're working very hard in this regard. I think that together with, unfortunately, visa regime is bound with readmission, and there is a difficult part of readmission when we're talking about the readmission of the citizens of the third countries if they travel through your country. But I think that we want to, I cannot give you the particular date when we can finish this negotiation. But I can assure you that the negotiations on visa liberation is going very, very intensive.
Shall we take
a
final round?
Last question was chairmanship of the Minsk group, France. It's a very important question. You know, it's from time to time in our media in Azerbaijan, foreign ministry and, is criticized, and, the authorities of Azerbaijan is criticized that co-chairs, and including myself, I'm sharing part of this criticism, that through the last 20 years of negotiations, we cannot reach any breakthrough for the conflict resolution. And sometimes it's also some idea.